So without further ado, I'm going to turn it over to Marina. Marina and I have worked together for many years here at the County Health Department. She's one of our senior environmental specialists, and we did ask her to come speak to us today about some of the hazards that you may come into contact with or are introduced to in a hoarding situation. So she's been doing these trainings for well over 20 years. Yeah. To many disciplines. She's very happy to be here to speak to us today, and we're really happy to have her. So thanks, Marina.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to actually play a little video. I do actually lead us, too. We started many years ago. I have to give her a plug here, because when we first started doing safety trainings, nobody really wanted to do safety trainings, so it was basically either someone died, injured, or a union grieved. You know, so you obviously can tell the kind of audience that you would be sitting in front of, you know. So, raw vegetables and rotten different things, sorry. And we would literally have to, in some cases, drag them kicking and screaming. And we've been benefited by the fact that we've lived long enough and we've been working long enough to now see a tipping point in that practice. Municipal sector used to be the worst offenders of environmental health and safety practices, towns, cities, towns, etc. And they are turning their practices around, and they are now coming around and we are getting so incredibly busy relative to these types of ocean occupational health and safety trainings. I'm going to show you a little video, and I want you to look to see. I know it's entertaining in a kind of sick way, but I want you to see if you can. Any of those?
The song goes well with it.
The song goes real well with it. That's okay. Anyone?
Job security.
Job security for you guys in the fire service emergency. Yeah, absolutely.
It could all be avoided.
It could all be avoided. Every single one of those, actually, through process of a hazard identification, could have been averted and avoided. All of those practices were clearly hazardous. And clearly identifiably hazardous, almost all of them anyway, and could have been prevented easily if they had just identified the hazard and taken mitigating or preventative method towards it. So when Lee asked me to do this presentation, I thought, oh, this will be so straightforward and easy. I have to give credit to another woman in here, Nancy Ellis Ice, right in the front row. And actually, when I was a young bup, she had the presence of mind to hire me for the first time in the public health field. And it was awesome, because I couldn't have had a better boss in the universe for the first time. And actually, I came across a lot of hoarding situations when I worked in as a local public health agent. I worked for the town of Brewster, then I went to the town of Chatham, and then I went to the town of Dennis. And it was during my capacity as a local agent that I actually came across hoarding situations for the very first time, usually with a fire or police calling me in and saying, you know, we need to condemn the house, etc. Back in the day, it was a little more problematic. I remember one particular one on Route 6A that Nancy and I, a vet, and it's horrifying when you first see it. So I actually have some experience with hoarding situation from a public health aspect. The other capacity that I have is, as I was thinking about what I should do to present, is the environmental health. I've actually seen hoarders. One of the hoarders that Lee and I were reminiscing on this morning was a gentleman in Sandwich. And his particular collection was 55-gallon drums of chlorinated solvents and toxics that he would collect at the dump back in the day, because he thought he saw value in them, and he thought that he could turn them around at some point, you know, henceforth in the future. So he would take these 55-gallon drums of material and store them in his backyard and hoard them. Well, they don't last outside very long at all, and what ended up happening was he ended up creating a contamination plume, which basically blew out an entire neighborhood in Sandwich over by Snake Pond, is it? Snake. And so anyway, so you guys could run into any kind of situation in a hoarding situation. And so the level of the ability to identify hazards is going to fall on you. And there's a lot of them, by the way. These are just the ones that I could think of. So when I was talking to Lee, I thought maybe the first thing I should do is actually just go over a very, very common OSHA training. And you guys need to talk to me, too, about in what capacity. Are you the first people to go into these situations? Usually? Okay. Sometimes, yeah, okay. I know the fire services. I've actually been called out in Harwich to a couple hoarding situations in the past when the health agent was unavailable. And you almost, in a way, under OSHA, do you consider this an aspect of your employment? Is it a duty of your employment to do this kind of work? So you would be considered employees, correct? You wouldn't be considered volunteers or helpful citizens. As under OSHA, as an employee, you would be required to actually have what's called hazard communication standard training. What hazard communication standard training is very simply the ability to understand what is hazardous, routes of exposure, and then taking it from there, building on that to see how you do and use PPE. And PPE, basically, personal protection equipment, is simply a method to block a route of exposure from an identified hazard. Okay, do you understand? I'm going to make you understand now because we're going to quickly go through. I'm going to go through much faster than I would. And I was going to offer that Lee is very able to do these types of trainings for you. And I can also come back to. I have no problem coming back. But basically, can you answer these questions? What's a hazardous material? Okay. Name three characteristics of hazardous material. Name the most common route of chemical exposure. Name the most common route of infectious agent exposure. What's an MSDS? What's a carcinogen? And what's PPE? Can you answer all those questions? Okay, I gotta tell you, when we first started doing teachers in school, science teachers at the high school level, it was an 80% failure rate of this small little quiz. That's frightening for a science teacher, okay? So I just wanna say, it's not like you're born with this knowledge. You are not born with this knowledge. You acquire it over time. OSHA does have a sense of humor, and they actually have a contest every year to do the five worst place practices, and they have pictures and photos. So you'll see those peppered. We're only going to take this PowerPoint just to a minute, okay? The whole thing is to make you think safely and think safety first. I know it's an emotional environment when you're dealing with a hoarder. I know it can be very heart-rending, and sometimes the emotions can to take you away and possibly cause exposure of a problem. But the very first thing really is, whose safety? Your safety. The hoarder is secondary, not to minimize the hoarder, but you're not going to be able to help very many people if you injure yourself in the job or you end up becoming ill yourself. So this is the basic information. The communication standard, or hazard communication standard, is OSHA. It is just a simple 101. And all we're going to take it to, actually, is this. We're only going to take it to routes of exposures, and we're not going to do any of this today. We're going to do some PPE in a different variable PowerPoint. This actually was a school in Nauset, actually. It's Nauset High School. So that actually was school pictures. Yeah, you know, back a while ago. It's hopefully not that. Okay. Yeah, back in the day. Okay, by law, you have the right to know what hazardous chemicals you work with, associated hazards, and how to protect yourself from hazards. You are unlike most employees that you come in and you use methyl ethyl bad stuff, you know, every day, and that's what you do. And you could come across virtually anything in a hoarding situation, virtually anything, and be exposed by virtually any route, by the way, too. So yours is a much more complex kind of PPE program because it's identified by virtue of every situation that you find yourself in. There's no uniform situation. Oh, this is the same as the one we did last week. Oh my God. It doesn't happen that way. So it's simply not. So you have to be fluent enough in hazard identification for you to say, and all it means is, are you an expert after this training? No. But what does it provide you? Maybe with enough information where you will not get sick or die or get injured. Okay, and basically I work with Rob in the back in the Harwich Fire Department as training officers. It gives you enough information to say, I need more information before I do anything in this place. Okay, do you know what I mean? You walk away from it and say, you know, before I can actually help you, I need to identify what could possibly harm me or others in this environment and take precautions to prevent that. Okay, so yours is a little harder than most employees or employers that I work with. And again, truthfully, the truth be told, your employer is actually required to provide a safe working environment. Well, that's not really practical, because what would they do? Okay, you can't go into any of these sites, you can't do anything to help. No, but they can say, you know what, we're going to train you so you can identify hazards so that you can prevent problems if you come to a site that you don't know information about. Employees are required to obey those, okay? So again, I'm not going to, obviously the whole point of these types of training is what? To prevent injury, all right? Again, your situation. IT was telling me that this isn't calibrated well, so I'm just trying to, okay? I'm not gonna go over this, but typically, in the gold standard of the world, you guys would have a written program. And maybe that's something that we could help evolve over time. It's not gonna be something that's gonna happen overnight, but your agencies would have a written program dealing with work situations and how to protect employees from those situations. It would be an SOP or an SOG, standard operating procedures or guidelines, and it could be very simply stated and written and outlined. Again, any safe work procedures, practices, and plans, meaning let's say PPE is required in certain situations. How do you know how to use that? Well, you have to have a written PPE program required. We're going to go into, PPE is not as easy as one would expect. It's not easy at all, as a matter of fact, and it's the last choice, and you need to be trained. Again, these are actually our towns. I've actually done that, I'm embarrassed to admit. You do what you need to do. Why do people do these kinds of things? Why do you do unsafe things? Well, because you don't have another option at that time, or you don't feel you have another option at the time. Maybe you're not trained. It's the best tool. You don't have the right tool for the job, so you do the best you can when you need to, okay? Which is why accidents happen, just like we saw in the video. All right, now I teach in the maritime, and this is a great way that I found for the students to build on knowledge, a knowledge base. It gives you a good foundation for you to interpolate or to decide and make decisions. At least, you know, they'd be reasonably good, in my opinion, okay? Hazardous material characteristics. Now you're saying, what's a hazardous material have to do with my hoarding situation? Well, actually a lot. We're gonna go into the types of hazards I've identified just in hoarding situations that I've seen. And you'd be surprised, characteristics, okay? Hazardous materials. There are six general characteristics, only six, okay? If you can identify the characteristic of the hazard that you visualize, and you can identify a route of exposure, you actually can pretty well produce, or at least to the point where you won't injure yourself significantly, a PPE program. You can pretty much arm yourself with appropriate PPE. Okay, the first hazard is toxic. A material can be toxic, okay? What do I mean by toxic, all right? Well, obviously poisonous. It can, from a standpoint of what you guys actually do, do any of you actually do any of the clean out yourself? Yes, no? Yes, okay, you guys do, okay? Do any of you use the cleaning products and disinfectant products that you would need for the clean out when you get to that point? Okay. Okay, so fair enough to say. So again, exposure to these types of materials, there are certain infectious agents, obviously, that are toxic. We're going to talk about those too, which are generally found in waste debris, human feces, animal feces, degrading corpses, things of that nature. Okay, corrosive material, okay, by virtue of the fact that they either are acidic or base, they can burn the skin and et cetera. All right, flammable material. Reactive, explosive, or oxidizing. Most of these you may not come across, but have you ever been in a hoarding situation where you might find chemical products in the bathroom or chemical products in the kitchen? Yes? Okay. All right, infectious is what I think is one of the major potential hazards you're going to come across relative to these types of situations. Radioactive or a combination of any of the above. Okay, so I'm going to test you right away, okay? Bleach. Everyone use bleach here? Do you use bleach in a hoarding situation perhaps at some point? Yeah. OK.
Okay. What are the characteristics of bleach? What's the first characteristic of bleach?
Corrosive.
It's, well, and what do you use bleach for, you guys?
Disinfecting.
Disinfecting. So what's the first characteristic, would you say?
Toxic.
It's toxic. Okay. Anything that disinfects, anything that kills anything, even microbes, has toxic properties. Okay. It's definitely corrosive. Toxic, corrosive, and something that you might not think about that the fire guys would. It's reactive and an oxidizer. Okay, it has those potentials. So you're already kind of, how about gasoline? Gasoline.
Toxic.
Flammable is one of the first characteristic that I would identify. Toxic, definitely has toxic characteristics. It may even, some people would argue, have corrosive because you can use it as parts cleaner. You can actually use it to do parts cleaning and degreasing. Right, so you get what I'm getting at? We can, and you're already auditing. You're already thinking in those terms of like, oh, this material, what is the characteristic? If you can identify the characteristic, you can protect yourself. Again, poisonous, it can be in any state, gases, solids, or liquids. Remember, I teach 18 to 22-year-old boys, so to me, you get to captivate their imagination, you know. So anyway, no, you think I'm joking. I'm serious. Anyway, corrosive, acid or base, these actually are at schools, local schools in the time. Flammable, catches fire easily. Infectious, okay? Now, infectious is your category, I think, a lot. Not that you're not going to run into these other types of problems associated with a hoarding situation, but infectious probably is your most. Anything's possible. The guy could be collecting plutonium. You know, it's possible radioactive waste could be there. It's not very probable that it will be, okay? The biologicals, bloodborne, biohazards, pathogenic, okay, all of those, okay? Bloodborne path, Lee could definitely do a bloodborne path training for you. Bloodborne pathogen is another OSHA standard training specific to bodily fluids, okay? Although blood is the only one OSHA recognizes as an occupational hazard, they are trying to get a handle on respiratory hazards, infectious respiratory hazards, things. It's just not easy to do. I mean, can you imagine trying to regulate cold viruses or that lady's sneeze right now? Oh my God, regulate that, quick, PPE, Don. You know, you just can't. So from a standpoint of airborne material and respiratory hazards, you're not gonna see regulations anytime soon in the general workplace population. Can you catch things other than bloodborne diseases on the job? Absolutely, absolutely, okay. So again, radioactive properties. I know. And this, I always ask my classes, is there a regulation for that? Do you think there's a regulation for that?
I don't know.
No? No, there's not. Are regulations proactive or reactive processes?
Reactive.
They're reactive. And they're not only reactive, they're very reactive. You know, something has to happen routinely over, unless it's nuns and orphans, something has to happen routinely over and over again before somebody probably says, this is a problem, we need to regulate it at this point. Okay? Okay, now nothing is going to hurt you.
Back.
Let me go back this way. Oh, this way, yeah.
Neat.
Come on.
Neat.
Here we go. Rats of exposure. Okay, I love this. Is another OSHA. Now, this is what I made the point as. Is Mr. Pink Shirt violating any regulations there? It's a level 2 hazmat site. Is Mr. Pink Shirt violating regulations?
Probably not.
Actually, he's not. Why? Because he's not a worker. Is it any less hazardous to Mr. Pink Shirt? No. But he's just not a worker, so he's not covered by OSHA. Okay. So again, you know, and this actually, anybody that's ever done field work, this is just entertaining because this happens all. People will, some student will always say, didn't they have tape around it? Why did they? Oh, absolutely. You think little tape's going to stop these people? Under, and they're like walking. You know, level 2, do you think there might be a hazard here? Oh, Martha, take my picture. So anyway, routes of exposure. None of the materials we described in characteristics can hurt you unless they do what? Get into you. Okay, and there's only 4 ways that that happens. 4 ways, okay? Inhalation, ingestion, absorption, and puncture or injection. All right, those are the only 4 ways things can get into you. The only 4 ways that things can hurt you, all right? For you guys, you know, I'm gonna go in, you guys, I try to evaluate, you have every single route in your job as far as potentiality, okay? But inhalation in general is the major route of exposure for most types of workplace scenarios, simply because you can't stop breathing for long, you know? you know, you just can't. You have to breathe eventually. It also is usually the, they have, lungs themselves actually have very large surface areas. People tend to think lungs are like big balloons, but actually they're more like big sponges. And if you dissect all of the little bronchioles and bronchi and alveoli, and you actually had that patience and you laid it flat, it would occupy the size of an average classroom floor. It's a very large surface area, okay? So a lot of potential for exposure here. It's also a direct route to the blood. Anyone who's ever had a medical procedure, you know, count backwards from 100, you know, what do you usually get to? Yeah, me too. I'm like, 98, and I'm out, okay? So again, and you can't start breathing. All right, ingestion is not only eating. People tend to think, I worked with a PhD chemist teacher in one of the trainings I did at high school, and she said, I don't know about you, but my staff doesn't eat their chemicals. Well, you know what, that's the least route, although you will have people that might actually, you know, try to do that in, you know, suicidal manner. Most of the time, ingestion has to do more with translocation or hygiene practices, okay? Not washing your hands, okay? We're gonna cover that because one of the major hazards that I identify for you guys is a pathogen called Toxoplasmosis gondii. And Toxoplasmosis gondii is actually a component, it's a protozoan disease, and it's a component of cat feces. Any of you have any hoarding situations with cat feces around? Okay, it's a very common component. We're going to talk about it because it's a really interesting pathogen, and it's associated with crazy cat lady syndrome, ironically enough. It has been indicted in, believe it or not, it's been indicted in ADHD, OCD, schizophrenia, and also suicide. Okay, and it's an interesting disease. You might remember it from the fact that if you ever were pregnant, you weren't allowed to change the kitty litter. Do you remember
I
that?
Still hold my kids are 17 and 20. Yeah. I have not touched the cat.
That's amazing. Yeah, that's amazing. They estimate that about 11% of the U.S. population actually tests positive for the titer. Meaning what? Meaning we have been exposed to 11% have been exposed. So anyway, it's a very interesting parasite. But that's one of the ones that I thought might be the most problematic for you. So again, and the most common route of exposure for T. gondii, eating food with your hands contaminated with feces of cats, basically. That's the major route of exposure is ingestion, actually, for T. gondii. Inhalation is not really a huge route of exposure. Absorption is not a route of exposure. And certainly, you know, we don't talk about injection, maybe possible. So ingestion is the major route of exposure. Cross-contamination is another one. Stupid things that people don't think about, like not washing their hands and smoking a cigarette. Okay, people don't think smoking is a right exposure, but you touch your lips, then you lick your lips, and that is the right exposure. The other one that I think is major, especially when you have ultrafines in the air, like particulates, aerosols, vapor, gases, mists, would be attenuation of mucous membranes in the upper respiratory tract. Okay, and that would be what happens. Has anyone ever done like a dirty job, like raking or cleaning it? Oh. Forgive me, of course, that's what you do in a hoarding situation. But when you, and then you blow your nose and it's filled with black stuff that is attenuated from your work practices, that's a good example of attenuation to mucosal epithelium. And what happens to that if you don't blow your nose? You swallow it, as postnasal drip or whatever. So again, that is another ingestion exposure. For the most part, most of these things are toxic enough to affect you with that type of minuscule absorption. But let's take T. gondii, for example. Let's take some of the other more toxic materials. The potentiality of exposure at that case could be real as far as ingestion exposure. Okay. Absorption actually is a hard one. Absorption actually, I just told you about ingestion. Ingestion actually is involved in the process of digesting food and absorption. But technically, it's kind of a nuance, but absorption actually occurs all over. It occurs, everyone's aware of skin, okay? Everyone is absorbed through the skin. You have the little patch, and you have the nicotine, and you have the seasick patch, and everything else. However, your eyes, surface of your eyes, your membranes of your upper respiratory tract, your mouth, okay, all constitutes an absorption exposure, okay? You think about, what am I trying to say? All I can think of is illicit drugs, whatever. But you think about like snuff or something, they used to sniff up their nose and absorption through the mucosal lining. Again, even the alimentary canal, absorption occurs at all levels through there. So again, every orifice and opening, absorption can occur as that exposure, okay? So absorption is a big one too. Needle sticks is something that you think, ah, oh, we don't have syringes in hoarding situations. Well, you might actually have syringes in hoarding situations, whether they're illicit drugs or maybe very ethical drugs like diabetics or whatever. But it also includes shards of glass. It includes metal. It includes splinters. It can include dog bites. It can include cat bites. It can include insect bites. Okay, anything that breaks the skin and punctures does constitute an injection or puncture exposure. Okay, so tick diseases, Lyme's, everything else would be a puncture exposure. Okay, you know what? I think that's it. I'm going to actually not it for that, but it for the HazCom anyway. I'm going to pull up. I'm going to pull up general PPE first. I'm going to leave respiration or respirators for last because respirators are probably what you use the most. Am I right? Dust masks and things of that nature, respiratory protection. Do you use any PPE already? Okay, you do because you do it for a living. So you have OSHA on your side. Okay, good. All right, so let's look at this. You know, I'm going to quickly go through it because I know you don't have a ton of time. And this is like trying to, you know, all of these trainings alone are like, you know, 6 hours or more. The hierarchy controls for chemical or any kind of hazard, actually. Okay, now, there is an industrial hierarchy. PPE is actually the last on the list. It's the last choice, okay? It's the last choice because it's a pain in the ass beyond, okay? It is very difficult to maintain and manage PPE. So it's your last choice to protect your employees. First choice is you try to eliminate the hazard. Now, in your situation, you know, a torch, a gasoline, you know, how can you eliminate that? I mean, you're not gonna actually do that. So that's not gonna be really valid. Engineering controls are examples of things like stupid proofing a process, like downdraft spray booths, not even having the employee focus on any aspect of it. It's taken out of their control through engineering practices. You know, I don't know. I see them in occupational setups, but I don't think that would be applicable to you. Administrative controls are the next, which is a little more for ergonomics and things of that nature. I won't go into it, but PPE is really, for your situation, man, I don't think there's options, truthfully. There isn't really an option. You can't engineer a practice, you know, to get rid of it. You can't eliminate the problem. You can't substitute it. So you're really stuck with PPE, which is actually not the best thing in the world, because PPE is a challenge. I'm going to go in, this is why PPE, and I'm just going to tell you, because it is difficult. I'm going to just tell you the issues surrounding PPE. First of all, it's difficult to choose the right PPE. I cannot tell you how hard it is. I do PPE programs for industry a lot, and it's not easy at all. So choosing the correct PPE is difficult because it varies to the identified hazard. Can you get that? So in some situations, you might have to use an N95, and in some situations, you might have to use a cartridge-style respirator for organic vapors. Okay, you got it? Some situations, you might have to use SCBA. You know, but not likely, but in some situations, it may be required. Likewise, as difficult as it is even for gloves, but I'm going to throw out to you this information. PPE is wicked uncomfortable. If anyone actually had worn it, it's not like you want to hang out at home in it, like, oh, bring me another beer, honey. You know, you just don't want to hang out in it. And it's pinches, it's binding, it's hot. It sometimes decreases productivity and mobility. It's not the funnest thing to wear. So what happens when people get uncomfortable? They take it off, okay? It's true. It must be maintained in order to be effective. It has to be maintained, and that's not easy either, unless it's disposable, one-time disposable. And it can also provide a false sense of security. We have people, if you actually look at the small print on these N95 masks that you purchased at Home Depot, you know, you look at it gives all the ratings and the NIOSH and ANSI standards and things. And the very bottom it says, caution, this respirator does not provide oxygen. Really? But you know why it's there? It's there because why? Someone thought it did. And they went into an environment that was anoxic. I'm safe. And they died. Okay? So again, you know, you, it's just, it's funny if it weren't so sad. So when is PPE required or recommended? Whenever there is a hazard that cannot be prevented by any other means. That's basic. So if you can't use the engineering, substitution, elimination, administrative, and you guys actually are, I thought, maybe you guys can spill out to me some other scenario, but you're kind of stuck with it. You don't have any other options, truly, except hiring an outside firm to come in and do it. You know, I'm not recommending that, but again, because that's costly and sometimes not practical either, okay? Whenever the PPE can effectively prevent injury, PPE needs to be used. This is all OSHA. This is not, you know, you should do, again, what we talked about with that little video, should do a hazard assessment to determine if PPE needed for a particular job, and if so, what type is required, okay? Hazard assessment, again, hazard assessment. Who does a hazard assessment? Well, who else is on the job with you? Do you have the safety engineer along with you for the ride? So who's doing the hazard assessment? You guys? I mean, I don't know. Are you? Are you the ones that actually see the and walk into the environment? So you really need to have some level of expertise to at least identify major hazards.
Okay.
PPE. Okay. So, I always love this. Isn't that a great job? That would not be a job I would want. Okay. Eye protection. I don't know. How about you guys? Eye protection? What kind of problems might you? Any scenarios? I can think of a few, but I'm not sure in your workplace. Eye and face protection. I know you're going to say respirators. Hmm?
Basically anything that you can inhale.
Absorb. Exactly. And that's, thank you very much. And so what I want to point out to you is required whenever there's an injury that could be prevented by wearing eye protection. Okay, I'm going to go quickly. Right. I'm going to show you just quickly. Just when you thought you may know everything about safety glasses, you don't. Okay. Safety glasses are like mine. Okay. Safety glasses are provided for impact hazards. This isn't a perfect, but they're better than none at all. But many safety glasses, I'm seeing if anyone has anyone around your neck, the lady in the back, they roll around the face a little bit. And they provide a little, they're impact goggles, basically. And they're right here, you can actually see. These are the standards you see in industry. What were they designed to do? They were designed to protect you from impact hazards, things flying at great speed through the air towards your eyes, okay? So mowing, cutting, grinding, sanding, bush cutting, chainsawing, okay? These are great glasses for that design. Do these glasses protect you against, as you gentlemen said? No, no. They don't protect you against absorption. They're totally open to the air. They circulate air above and beyond, okay? Regularly vented goggles, this is where people, indirectly and regularly vented goggles are where people get kind of confused. Regular vented goggles fit like a face mask, you know, like a snorkeling mask, but they have regular vents on the side. So they're not really good. They protect your eyes from dust, sparks, and flying particles, but not gases, mist, aerosols, and vapors, okay? They won't. They're just sealed that way, okay? Indirectly vented goggles protect your eye from chemicals and dust, aerosols, mist, vapors, gases. They close fit to your face, and they have louvered vents. These are actually what they look like. They have louvers on the side that are one way. So you could full chemical splash to the face, liquid, but for your case, you're not going to be splashing much stuff, I hope, you know, in your scenario. But aerosols, mist, vapors, gas, dust, particles, fines, things of that nature, possibly so. Full face shield, okay, is also an option. However, it needs to be worn with safety goggles to be compliant. So you have to do that assessment and analysis of what you need to do. So here, indirectly vented, you can see, this is indirectly vented here, okay? These are indirectly vented. These are vented goggles. These are the ones with the slashes. And you see the little louver vents on the top? So, you know, in a lot of cases for you guys, if there's a chance that aerosols or vapors or mists or dust or fines are circulating and absorption is a potential exposure, what do you want to use? You want to use these, okay? You definitely want to use these. Ding! Okay. All right. This is just, I'm sorry, anyone really grossed out at gross pictures? Okay, you better close your eyes. I had one of my cadets. He was a 6'4" cadet. After a bloodborne lecture, he got up, passed out. He just passed right out, man. It was funny. And I thought, you know, he woke up saying, I'm a hemophobe. Again, impact goggle, impact protection, okay? All of this. Do they work? Yes, they work. You can see it actually caught one of the rebound staples. So again, safety glasses work when they're worn appropriately, but how do you know which ones to wear? You have to assess the hazard. You have to know the type of characteristic of the materials that you're dealing with and the route of exposure, okay? Don't do this, don't, go back. Okay, let me see. Goodness, hold on. All right. And this one's funny, at least he's wearing eye protection. He's like in a pool on an aluminum ladder with an electric corded drill. You know, electrocution hazard. You know, I try to look, when I do have assessments in the workplace, some workplaces are so bad that I try to just pick what will kill you fastest, you know, and I just deal with that. Let's do this one first and we'll work down from there, right? This will kill you faster than the back injury. Okay, so gloves. All right, gloves are another means, and I'm just gonna quickly, because gloves are probably, you do use gloves, correct? You must, okay. All right, they protect against corrosive toxins, protect against physical hazards, splinters and hammers and things of that nature, and protect against infectious agents, which I think is probably what you are most concerned about. How many think gloves are easy to choose for PPE? Oh my God, they are the worst. They are the worst. I have funny stories, actually. So metal mesh leather or canvas gloves, they're made from metal mesh leather or canvas, and they provide protection from cuts, burns, and sustained heat. Okay, fabric and coated cotton or coated fabric gloves. These plastic transform fabric gloves into hand protection offering slip resistant qualities. Think UPS, think postal service gloves. They actually, people picking up packages to prevent slips of their hands. Okay, made of cotton or other fabrics, protect against dirt, slivers, chafing, and abrasions, but do not provide sufficient protection against rough, sharp, or heavy material. Fabric and coated fabric gloves. Nitrile gloves, generally recommended for exposures to bloodborne pathogens or infectious agents, okay? Latex was acceptable, but the sensitivity, it's an environmental sensitizer. So OSHA has this big focus now on sensitizing agents because they heretofore have not been regulated. You're gonna begin seeing them regulated because sensitizing agents are prevalent in our culture and in our products, but they've kind of escaped, and now we're seeing what happens when people get sensitized to these types of products, and latex is an example of that. So nitrile is the one to choose for infectious agents and probably one of the ones you most generally need. Why do you need gloves for chemical exposures that cause simple irritation, defatting, dermatitis? Chemicals can be corrosive and burn. Chemicals can pass through the skin and enter the bloodstream. Example of, we have a dermatitis here, which is a simple detergent, surfactant, just soap and water. Over here we have a chemical burn. Actually, this is a good example. He was wearing a glove, but his glove was too short, okay? He was wearing a typical, and he fell into the chemical, and of course the chemical then went over the glove and into the glove and filled the glove, which then, okay? So again, when you're thinking about it, what length glove? This? Gauntlet? Shoulder, okay? And you never think of that, do you? You think, oh, the rest, let's just do the rest, because that's what you move. Hot tar is the worst I've ever seen. We were dealing with a DPW worker on the back of a patching rig and it jolted and he fell into the tar bath. And that so sucks, I can't even tell you, because you could cool it right away, but it's so viscous that it just holds heat through thermal mass. Okay, some chemicals will permeate without visible evidence. Some chemicals will visibly degrade gloves. Some need to consider contact time, concentration. I am going to go through this quickly because it's complex, but I want you to at least hear it. You need to consider if multiple chemicals are used, which is the greatest, best to rely on glove manufacturer. Okay. I don't know why I keep doing that, but I do. Okay. No. Let's take it down to, okay. So you need to think of things which you never think about, I'm sure. Breakthrough time. These gloves are rated. Chemicals actually break through the glove lining, depending on what glove you're wearing. Degradation time, okay? Permeation rate. And a lot of these things you're not gonna worry about unless you're dealing with chemical toxins. This is what a glove chart looks like, you guys. Isn't that fun? Okay. So we're dealing with acetone. Nitrile is not recommended. PVC is not recommended. Neoprene, 10 minutes only. Butyl, greater than 17 hours. Okay. So again, you can look up the chemical, carbon disulfide, dichloroethane, ethanol, ethyl ether, formaldehyde, hexane, hydrochloric acid, isopropanol. Again, you can look to see what will work and how. And that's just one consideration. I'm going to quickly scroll through. These are the things you have to think about for gloves. What kind of dexterity is needed, okay? I cannot tell you, we had the police department. Police guys are so much fun to work with in PPE. But they surge, yeah, if you laugh, the fire guys are laughing, oh, because they know, okay? So they have to go in and check pockets of offenders, and oftentimes there might be syringes, and oftentimes they get stuck. So they wanted to design PPE for needle sticks. Well, they have them. They're called armor gloves. They're like chainmail. Okay, they're like $150 a pair. Okay, so they purchase these chainmail gloves, right? Only to find out the first time they go to use them, guess what? They have no dexterity. They can't feel a thing. Okay, so that and right in. You know, I mean, it's just crazy. So dexterity. What is the concentration of the chemical you work with? What is the length of time which your glove is exposed to chemical? What is the temperature? Isn't it a bummer if you like your gloves melt on your, oh, bummer, I wish I thought of the temperature. Okay. Is there a possibility of abrasion or puncture? What length of glove do I need? Are there latex allergies? And what is the cost? I think the most interesting one I did was for cryogenic material for hospitals for liquid nitrogen. Specialized glove for liquid nitrogen use. It's kind of interesting. Okay, latex is not considered protective, and nitrile is not considered protective for chemicals. So if you happen to be working in one area of the hoarding situation and you have to go clean an area, you might consider, depending on what you're cleaning and using, that these two uses might be not compatible for the particular gloves that you have on. You might have to use variation. Okay. Any of you have single-use gloves? You all use single-use gloves, right? Do any of you reuse gloves? Like the big Playtex living gloves kind of thing? If you choose to, because Playtex living gloves are not bad things. They're actually, in some situations, they will save your life, okay? But if you're reusing gloves, which you're allowed to do, you have to have a maintenance inspection program, meaning you have to know enough, or your employees have to know enough, that when they put it on, they have to inspect it to make sure there's no signs of cracks or fractures or thinning or breaks or wear or anything, and then put them on or otherwise just them. See what I mean? Are you getting the gist that it's not easy? It's like, here, take these gloves and go in. Okay, it's not that easy. Okay, and you don't need hard hats, correct? Maybe in some situations. I was doing this and I'm thinking maybe I should include that. Obviously, hard hats have a purpose, and if you need them, you can look at manufacturer's recommendations. Any fall hazard? This is an interesting one. This is not actually urban myth. I'm doubting whether the guy might have not been sober, A, might have been suicidal, B. But anyway, he was working in Colorado doing framing, and he was firing the stud gun, and it backfired. And he thought actually it got caught in the stud behind him, so he thought he was okay, allegedly. A week later, he started having mouth pain. He went to the dentist, and they found this. Actually entered up through the top of his mouth. And you know, how does that happen? We tried to figure it, like, you know, I don't even know how that could happen, but he said that's what happened, and actually it was removed, and he was fine. But can you imagine that? I don't know that any PPE. I am going to include feet, because God knows what you could be running into. Something as simple as just slip and fall because of all the stuff, but then piercing and nail and a sharp object, steel toe, things falling on you, really any of those things could happen. And I don't know, you can correct me if I'm wrong, but I'm imagining horror situations with things falling on you, objects falling with heavy weight, stepping on something with nails or sharp objects going through the bottom of your foot. Okay, so again, protecting your feet, actually, no one thinks, I bet you never came here thinking you were gonna have feet protection, right? Did you think about that one? So I was thinking about it because I'm thinking it could actually happen. So there are many different types. Actually, I have one on now. These are electrical and they are steel toe. They actually have a steel toe, but not through the metatarsal area, just on the toe. You can actually purchase metatarsal protection, meaning that the box, my box just goes to here, but you can actually get a steel box that can go all the way up the metatarsal. So if you're expecting something really heavy to fall, you can protect your entire foot box. But again, electrical insulation, puncture protection, impact and compression, slip and fall, all of these things. I don't. Electrical hazard, is that a potential in hoarding situations? It could be too, right?
Yeah.
So again, electrical hazard, so insulation of the foot, of the shoe, all of these things. So again, things to consider. One thing I will tell you, ANSI, OSHA doesn't regulate PPE. ANSI, MEMSHA, and NIOSH, okay, those are the three regulating agencies. They have a number. So interestingly enough, you can take your shoe off and you can actually see the NIOSH, ANSI, or MEMSHA number. Plug it into Google and you'll see what the standard of the shoe is, of any PPE for that matter. I brought some N95s, so we'll look at that. But you can type in the number, classes, it has the ANSI, NIOSH, or MEMSHA number, and you can type in the number and you can actually see what the rating is for that to see if you've gotten the correct rating. Right. It's usually in shoes, it's on the tongue. I didn't bring it because I knew. Okay, OSHA doesn't approve PPE, okay? OSHA acceptable, well, again, this is the NIOSH, ANSI, and MEMSHA. We've all seen that. ANSI also is ANSI, you'll see it as ANSI, ANSI. ANSI standard, MEMSHA is the Mine Safety and Health Administration. So all of these will have numbers followed, NIOSH followed by the numbers, and you can look them up, okay, and you can see. Google is a wonderful thing. Google is so good. And smartphones are with everyone now. Okay, so a PPE program sets out procedures for selecting, providing, and using PPE as part of an employee's routine operation. The first essential step is to assess the workplace to determine if hazards are present. Remember, hazard determination, okay? Or likely to be present, which necessitate the use. Once the proper PPE has been selected, the employer must provide training to each employee who's required to use it. Is that being done now? I suspect not, because it's practically not being done anywhere. So, and you're not alone, trust me. But this is the gold standard. This is what you actually aim for, is this type of written protocol. I just got another partial amputation of a golf in a golf department. One of the guys, two partial amputations in the last 3 weeks. One was at one of the local airports, and one was at a golf department. And OSHA comes in, man, they have take no prisoners. And they don't, they really don't. And you know what, they don't have a lot of money for inspectional service, so what do? They wait till an accident happens, and then they nail that person to the wall. And so he just sent me the documents that OSHA sent, and they are just, he's like, help me. They'll find everything. They have one guy come through for health, one guy come through for safety, and they each write these magnificent reports that outline everything, and it's not cheap. So again, just to let you know, employees required to use PPE must be trained to at least when it is necessary. The employee has to know that, so it has to be trained. What type is necessary? How to properly put on, take off, adjust, and wear? Limitations of it, and proper care, maintenance, useful life, and disposal. Okay. These are minimum standards. There's OSHA after, the cowboy after OSHA. You know, it's a joke, but anyway, yeah. Doesn't really look like a cowboy at this point, but it's pretty funny. Okay, last but not least, any questions at all, just stop. Any questions? Is it okay to go a little over? I apologize. Respirator. I saved the best for last. Is it useful, though? Are you finding useful information? Okay. Respirator protection, I had to put this in because I think it's funny. These are cops in a smoke-filled situation, and I know the firefighters are going to laugh. But anyway, I got this online, and I think it's just funny. This is also, just to let you know, each of these are like about two-hour presentations, all right? So I'm speeding through them to give you a taste of it. Many people, respirator is one of the hardest presentations. I'm not going to go, I'm going to go through fairly quickly. First of all, respirator protection, when are they required? Well, they're required when there's a hazard exceeding PEL, exceeding permissible exposure levels given by OSHA. For you guys, that's not going to be really important. If you suspect that there's a respirable hazard present, then you need to don respirators and you need to figure out how to do it. So I'm not going to go into all of this. I can come back at some later date if you want to do specific trainings, but again, always in OSHA, you have a hazard identification, you have to have the written program. What I want to get into, though, is this, because many people don't get the basic aspect of medical screening. How many do you use respirators routinely? Anyone? A 95? Okay. And you can medically screen, too, appropriately? Medically screened appropriately?
No, I haven't been medically screened, but I got disposable cartridge respirator that I won't go into a hoarding situation.
I wouldn't either. I wouldn't either. I'm telling you, you're smart. The problem is, under OSHA, actually OSHA views N95s as legitimate respirators, okay, require medical clearance. What happens when you put on a respirator? So you're breathing. Resistance. It creates more labor, okay? Any respirator of any type, filter or even SCBA, has some component of respiratory resistance. When would it not be a good idea to put someone in a respirator with respiratory resistance? Well, think of this. How many of you have COPD, emphysema, heart disease, heart and lung disease, some kind of cardiac insufficiency? Put this on you and make you go do work? What's it going to do? Yeah, it's going to stress you. It's going to potentially cause a heart attack, death, episodes of any type, even asthma. So what OSHA wants you to do is they want you to be cleared medically before you even get tested and fit tested for respirators, even N95s, guys. We just did an N95 program over at the Cottage Hospital in Nantucket, and this is what they use. This is a medical. This is an N95. 1860, okay, and it gives all the information in NIOSH. It's NIOSH N95, it gives blah, 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 and all the certification information there. OSHA has a downloadable questionnaire, a 4-page questionnaire, that you can actually fill out. And if you answer like the appropriate answer to all of that, then you can clear yourself automatically. If you answer anything that indicates that to put on a respirator would cause additional hazard to pre-existing health condition, guess what? You have to go to an occupational physician for clearance, and a clearance to even be fit tested, okay? So the problem with respirators is they can be more of a problem than solving a problem, okay? So again, clearance is required, medical screening, fit testing, training, and respirator maintenance. Okay, and obviously you can't have beards or facial hair if you have any tight-fitting respirators because they won't fit close to the face. Okay, so you can't simply be handed a respirator. I'm going to go through all of this, okay, and you can read this. You have to determine which respirators are appropriate to ensure a respirator fits, doesn't cause harm to the employee. Respirators cause breathing resistance, which can be harmful to persons with pre-existing respiratory cardiac problems. And improper use can create more problems than they actually solve. This is an example of fit testing. The good news is that eventually our department will actually be set up to even fit test. This actually has to be fit tested. They actually fit test. I would have never believed it before that you could fit test an N95. But when I was over at the hospital in Nantucket, three of the med-surg nurses failed. They were wearing the wrong size respirator. And they were med-surg nurses in the operating room. Hello, really? You know, from a standpoint of potential exposure. So it is interesting, and it does work. And we will be set up as a department to actually provide these fit test trainings, and also to conduct the fit test. Right now, the fire department, the Barstool Fire Training Academy, actually has the quantitative fit test analysis, which is very different and much like gold standard. They can do your cartridge-style respirator. They can actually test you for that, and they could do that. And so I've already talked to Lee there, and he said he'd be happy to help any group to be able to do it. So there are actually options out there. This is what it looks like, you guys. This is a qualitative fit test, which is just with a bitter or sweet tasting substance. This is a quantitative fit test down here. This is the qualitative here for the N95, and then the quantitative has a computer respiratory. Okay. Again, you can take the medical questionnaire that you can find on OSHA at their e-tool, and you can take that out, or you can take a medical exam with an occupational physician. Okay. I'm going to not go into this because it just reiterates the importance of that kinds of things. One of the problems is masks are very, respirator protection makes it very difficult to wear other PPE, okay? So imagine wearing this and chemical splash goggles and hearing protection and whatever else you may need. So again, you have to look at what else you would be using in the scenario or situation to see if it's compatible with the PPE that you have. Different face sizes, amazingly so. Let me go ahead of this. This is the aspect of fit checking. Each time you use your respirator, you're actually supposed to do fit check in addition to the original fit check. I can come back later, but what I do want to just convey to you is, and there you go, the qualitative equipment here for the more advanced fit testing. Respirator care, follow the manufacturer's directions, inspect it before each use, repair or discard if necessary. Are you using one time? Clean it after each use, store in a clean plastic bag, replace cartridges, filters if it's hard to breathe or if you can tell, smell or taste the chemical. Tell me, you guys, do you only use this? I know this gentleman used cartridges, that's a whole different ball game. Do you mostly use these? Yes, no? Yeah? No one's even nodding. So none of you use them or you don't use them at all? You just go in blank? Okay. I know you're dealing also, and you're in a whole different arena than I am with the psychological and emotional aspects and human service, and that's something I don't deal with a lot. But I can imagine how you freak people out when you walk in with your PPE, and then you don't want to freak people out because, oh my God, they're going to feel different and weird, and and that's really something you're going to have to wrestle with because, as I said, the hazards that I've identified for you, I'll just quickly go through. I'm going to take this out. Okay. There's only two different styles of respirators. For some reason, it's just a thing. You know what? I'm going to actually just take it out here because it's a little bit easier. These are the two different types of this is actually air purifying. There's two different types. There's air supply and air purifying. That's all it is. Air purifying filters the available air. Air supply gives you an alternate source of air from somewhere else, okay, like a tank or a line or something. This is the type you guys use most predominantly. Check out, okay? Respirator N95, filter cartridge style, like this gentleman has, full face versus half face, okay? Think about PPE. And full face powder, powered purifying. This kind of one is kind of the gold standard. And for your uses, it would be the gold standard if you could afford it. The filter intake is actually in the back. So as you're working in this area where you're lifting dust and you're lifting particulates and things, it's not going to foul the filter unit too quickly because it's taking air from behind, okay? So that's actually a good choice for you. But if you're doing filter style, but there's only one guy that does it, so we can talk later maybe. You can see. You know what, I'm going to leave it there. We actually have little scenarios, like what type of respirator do you think is needed? You're entering a confined space where there may be a lack of oxygen or an unknown environment. You have no idea what's there. Airline, okay? So these scenarios you should actually think about as you're bringing that together. Okay, enough. Okay, so the identified hazards that I got for you they could be anything, all right? I see, actually, truthfully so, I hate to bring this to you. Some of the ones that I came up with, pathogens, obviously. T. gondii, huge. Hanta virus. You've all heard of Hanta? Hanta is actually on the rise, and it's identified actually even in Rhode Island last year. There were several people that actually came down with Hanta. Hanta is aerosoled mice urine and feces, rodent feces. How many of you have rodents in these hoarding situations? Like, Hanta is a very real hazard. Of all the things that I'm looking at, T. gondii, Hanta, probably the most frightening for the scenarios that you're going into. And guess what? They're both what? Airborne. Well, the Hanta is definitely airborne, respirable, and gondii is actually ingesting, but also, you know, if it gets on you, okay? So pathogens, huge. Cleaning up feces, blood, human waste, all of the things, bloodborne path, all of these things, that's a whole nother ball of wax because I was just actually reading an article about Philippines. And they have dead bodies hanging everywhere from this latest typhoon. And CDC sent out a recommendation saying, listen, we can't even deal with the bodies now. And they, by the way, they don't pose a huge, it's a myth that dead bodies pose a huge public health risk hazard. But guess who they pose the risk to? The people that are actually cleaning up the dead bodies and putting the dead bodies away. But it's not like a dead body over there is going to, you know, affect me. So again, you're up close and personal in this environment, so you are exposed close and personal to these types of bodily fluids, excrements, and things of that nature. Then you get into a whole another slew of human pathogens, okay, that can just blow you away. So from that standpoint, which is why I recommend probably bloodborne testing and bloodborne training from Lee, and she could take you through that, because that's a pretty easy one. Aerosolization of material, again, zoonotic material. How many of you are in situations for animals, that animals are involved? Cats, dogs, domestic animals, but also squirrels, rats, mice, birds. Okay, you don't even know the types. I mean, I could get into from a standpoint of zoonotic transmission and the things like the just the bird flu they're finding, which, by the way, they just even located variant number 3, H6N1. Have you heard of that one now yet? Okay, so you have H5N1, you have H7N9, and now there's actually an H6N1 variant. Okay, all emanating from what? Birds. Okay, transmission to humans. So again, you have all of these. I'm just going to put out to you. That's getting into just the infectious portions of it, which I think is one of your major, major. Then you get into allergies from a standpoint of mold. How many have mold? Okay, so mold. In this situation, I know a lot about mold because I do mold analysis myself. The worst would be the Stachybotrys, which would be the toxic mold they talk about, okay? Stachybotrys is very particular, only found in situations where you have a constant source of water. So if you have a situation, and I can see hoarding situations where you'd have plumbing leaks or plumbing backups or leaking from the outside chronically, okay? So Stachybotrys, black toxic mold, would actually be a potential. Now, does it kill you? You know, who knows? You know, Hurricane Katrina, Stachybotrys, maybe, but it's still not something that you want to, you know, be living with and inhaling. And that's a respirable hazard right there, okay? Other types of mold, other problems, okay? Certainly you're going to see Aspergillus, Penicillium, you're going to see the Cladosporium, you're going to see the types of molds we see on Cape Cod in a good situation, you know what I mean? Just the types because we live on Cape Cod, okay? But you're going to see it at that much more of a concentration. Do you have respirable allergies? Do you have sensitivities? Do you have asthma? Do you not want to have asthma? Sometimes routine and regular exposure to these types of environment can create allergies and sensitizing reactions in individuals, okay? Am I scaring you enough? I don't mean to scare you, but I'm putting out to you about what? Asbestos, all right? Asbestos is another area you don't think about. Most asbestos is in a non-friable state, for the most part. We have sheeting and wallboard and, you know, popcorn ceilings and things of that nature. Generally not friable, meaning generally not hazardous to you, but in the environment of a hoarder, you have moisture problems, you have lack of maintenance, lack of care, delamination, you have situations that can render asbestos-containing material friable, okay? So asbestos is not unreasonable. If the structure is before 1970 or older, the chances of it having asbestos present in the structure are large, and asbestos not in good condition, which means it could be friable. Again, we're looking also at like toxics, you know, just people collecting chemicals or paints or, I don't know, glues or products or cleaning solutions or anything else that might happen. That also is another potentiality, but I don't think that's as large, is it?
Actually, we heard from the Cooperative Extension that Cape Cod has a specialized, especially down in the Falmouth Woods Hole area.
Yeah.
A lot of Woods Hole scientists.
Yes! Oh my God!
And their wives didn't know what they brought home.
Yes, we find that all over the Cape.
And that also includes radioactive
material.
And reactive explosives.
Yeah.
So
it's not that far-fetched.
There is no hazard that you listed that
you won't find.
Are not likely to see. They seem to think it was especially in that area.
Oh yeah, because
but if you're a Woods Hole scientist, to it.
Wow. We've actually found them. Yeah, you know, it's fascinating, but much more likely. So that is too. I wanted to just tell you a little bit about T. gondii because it's kind of an interesting little parasite. It's a protozoan parasite, and it comes out of cat feces. It infects neurologically, so it infects actually rodents first. But it's very interesting. It affects the rodent to make the rodent less cautious. So it's a fascinating little organism. So the rodent becomes less cautious, kind of hangs out, and guess what?
Ends up your
pant leg. No, yeah, right, but the cat can catch it more easily and eat it, and its life cycle is then through the feline, and the cat poop then excretes the material. But the thing is they found a schizophrenic, the crazy cat lady. There may be actually the T-Gonda connection in crazy cat ladies, which is infecting neurological function, causing schizophrenia.
And other. T-Gonda?
Yeah, T-Gonda is toxoplasmosis gondii, G-O-N-D-I-I, gondii, T-Gonda. And so read a little bit about it, because also ADHD, OCD, they find that if one person in the family tests positive for titer, meaning they've had exposure, that it's likely that all of the people in the family actually have exposure to T. gondii. And as I was telling this gentleman earlier, suicide, particularly dangerous for pregnant women. That's why they tell you never to change cat litter, because it's a mutagen and it infects the child. It's it can either, bless you, kill the child or birth defects. So again, these are the N95s, you guys, I'm just going to put out to you. You can get little N95s that have odor, little carbon filters, in case, I'm sure some of these situations may have odor issues. Okay.
Some.
Yeah, some, okay. So again, you can actually get N95s that are coated with carbon that help a little bit with the odor situation if you have. You can buy many, many different types. You can really investigate. This particular one has an exhalation valve, which makes it a little more less heat buildup inside, more comfortable. The one thing that you need to know about N95s is they have to have two straps, okay? A proper and appropriate N95 regulated has the two straps. So this, you know that you've seen the one with a single strap? Not appropriate and not rated for it. Also, you can, they actually rate it with crossing. Crossing straps, okay? The crosses, I don't do it, but you have to cross the straps. I know this is like not very pleasant with my hair. But again, from a standpoint of crossing the straps and pinching the nose and taking it in, you can actually fit check. You can fit check an N95 too. This is a regular. They also have, and the only difference is S, small. So they have, 8110S is the small size, and you're fitted for that. And then you have 18S60, and again, no S, so the larger size. So it comes in small and large, that's it. So I hope this was helpful. Like I said, it's a lot of material. I hope I didn't confuse you terribly or, create. But again, you have so many options to come back and have more training. Yes?
Just to finish up and add a few things. Forever, military and civilians, both of us grew up in the Cape. One, I'd give kudos to Marina Brock. She's fantastic. We've worked with her for many years. She's such a good resource on anything. And I have to admit that, she's so good at all her stuff that, I'm lazy. Instead of looking up the ocean website, I got one question. I get lazy, I just call Marina. But she's a great resource, and I can't applaud her enough for the work she does down here. A couple of things that I just to echo what she said, and again, I grew up in the Cape, and the Cape is a whole different ballgame than it was from Patti Page singing My Cape Cod 20 years ago. When you go in a structure, there's a lot to be said for instincts. And if the fire service, and we've had to break this for years, you rush in, and we've learned to slow down. If the place isn't on fire, and they're not decapitated, there's no rush. And you're at the threshold of the door, and it looks bad, it smells bad, it probably is bad, right? So stop, go slow. And if you're not comfortable going in there, and you don't have your PPE,
right,
don't go in. Right? And I brought up health agents, I brought up other private environmental folks who've gotten in trouble, gotten dirty needle sticks, and they end up going to the emergency room, and if they had their PPE on, they had their gloves on, wouldn't it be a big deal? So I encourage you, if you don't have PPE, she's absolutely right, if it's in your job description, we get asked this, I get asked this all the time when I do CPR classes. If it's in your job description, your employee has to provide it. Case closed, done deal. Right? So if you have trouble with PPE, where to order it, I suggest you hook up with your fire department, maybe meet your local EMS officer. Your town probably already has a vendor, whether it's more medical or one of the other agencies. They'll show you the catalog. Stuff cheap compared to somebody getting hurt in one visit in the emergency room. It's cheap. It's cheap stuff. So slow down, wear your PPE, and you know when you're going in, we've gone in and we've learned to slow down. You know, they're answering us in the back bedroom, there's hoarding, there's cat litter, there's all sorts of stuff. We'll leave the equipment outside, put on a level one hazmat suit, go in there, take them out, and then, you know, and we find surprises all the time. What you think you're going in for, and you knock over a pair of, you know, a pile of newspapers that's been there since World War II, and you find a hand grenade that this has happened. I'm not, right? We're not making this up. And now, whoa. You know, so if it looks bad and it feels strange, anything's possible. Right? A couple other things, if you're unaware, dirty needle sticks. Unprotected exposure, medical dirty needle sticks. Right? And there's one, there's a huge heroin epidemic on Cape Cod. I mean, this is like, you know, New York City, just as bad as Philly anywhere, and we've never seen it this bad. My wife's an ER nurse at film, so they're out there. We found it down the beaches, on the parking lots, in houses, all over the place. If you get stuck with a dirty needle, right, that is, and I'm just the messenger from the CDC, from Mass Department of Public Health, that is an emergency now. So if you get stuck with a dirty needle, you need to go to the emergency room now. Not in an hour, not after lunch, not go home and take a shower, not, well, I can't get a hold of my employer, notify the town manager. No, you need to go now. So when you go to the emergency room, they are supposed to put you to the front of the line. They will give the usual spiel, sit down and have a talk with you, risk versus benefit. And there are antiviral medications out there, and they're coming up with new ones all the time. I wasn't aware of certain things, or, you know, there's AIDS, hepatitis, and all sorts of other bad stuff out there. And now there is. So, but the big reason that says to go to the emergency room now is that there are certain windows for these medications. If you go home, you take a shower, try to call your employer, and by the time you get down there, 3, 4, 6 hours later, you can file the paperwork, they're gonna tell you, oh well, too late.
Sometimes that window's only 2 hours.
Yeah, they're telling us now,
stick,
2 hours.
To treat, so by the time you get into all the paperwork in the ER and all that stuff, you're an hour and a half into it, and if you only have a 2 hour window, you go now.
How many of you have had HepaVax vaccination? Hep B?
Yeah.
All of you? I hope so. If not, it's something to look at with your employer to get Hep B. Because it's not the AIDS virus dies almost immediately, but it's the Hep that's the big one that's going to catch you. Okay. So be careful with that. So PPE, cost of PPE, this stuff is cheap. I can tell you, one trip to the emergency room with, you know, a puncture wound, and they're going to give you a tetanus shot whether you like it or not, and then you're out of work, you know, the cost is huge. And as Marina said, a lot of stuff can be prevented. So slow down, wear your PPE. If you got questions, call Marina. You know, touch base with your local fire department, EMS, you know, and maybe call them to the scene. We have a very good relationship in Harwich, and a lot of times we'll, you know, powwow with the house and all go in together. I've outfitted the police cruise the town with all booties and face masks. All right, you should be wearing that stuff. These houses all the time. All right, that's my speed. Sorry, it's doing fun.
It's awesome. Thank you for adding to that.
Well, I was just going to say, usually his lectures, he does a great lecture on burns. We talked about gloves, and we saw some burns. And that's one of those things that's can be life-changing.
Yeah.
There, a bad burn is any burn around the joint. This joint, jaw, elbows. But how many joints you got in your hands? And how much do you need your hands to do your job in your life? And the difference between being able to do this, and hug your kids, and having two claws is what you do in those first couple of minutes afterward. First thing you need to do is get out of it, stuff, and then get the heat gone or the chemical gone and make the call for rescue, because it's another small window of opportunity to make a huge difference in your life. If you get hand burns, especially chemical burns, around the joints of your fingers, you need to deal with that right now. And so if it can be prevented, it can be so much of a positive impact.
Maybe from our perspective, we're trying to give you some ideas to think about that. You know, in your mind, you're just going into a hoarding situation, trying to talk to them, you know, why are they stacking newspapers in 1945? But in reality, there's a whole slew of dangerous stuff there. I had one family member come down to try to deal with a hoarding situation with, you know, a relative. And usually when they're in the hoarding mode, you know, they're not paying attention to anything. They're a diabetic, just throwing their needles everywhere. They have Clorox bottles open, you know, and she put her hand through a pile of newspapers to try to move, right, and knocked over a Clorox bottle, didn't even see it, and we get called for a chemical burn. And how it's, that's how it started. You know, the sister came down from New York, and, you know, grandma's in a bad state, and went to help, and wasn't thinking, and put her hand through a pile of newspapers, and put her right in the block because, you know, there's nothing being done. You know, there's needles everywhere, there's Clorox bottles, so slow down and be careful, because anything is possible. All right, I promise you pulled me off
stage. No, thank you for adding to that. We definitely have to move forward. But I do want any questions for Marina or Rob or Bob in the back? Essentially,
thank
what we
you.
Wanted to
do.
Thank yeah, you. That was great. Thank you. There's a lot of information thrown at you today. As it, you know, Rob said, Marina's a great resource. I'm also a great resource if you
so
have any questions. Exactly. Your fire department, your health department, those are all great resources if you do have any questions. Again, you know, we talked about, you know, identifying the hazards or doing an assessment of the hazards. We don't know what we're walking into half the time. You have no idea what you could come across. So, you know, as the fire department has reminded us, you know, we need to slow down. We want, you know, and as Marina has said today, we want you to start thinking about how you can properly protect yourself when you're walking into some of these unknown situations. But again, think about the resources that you have in your communities, and also maybe talk to your employees about putting together certain protocols for PPE, proper PPE, these protocols and programs in place so that, you know, as Marina said, you're dealing with an emotional situation. You're walking into somebody's home. You're trying to build a relationship with this individual. You know, you're not going to don a full hazmat suit, gloves, goggles, you know, mask, everything that you may should be wearing because of the sensitive situation. But we do want you to stop and think about how you can properly protect yourself and use those precautions. And then, again, if you have a program set in your department or with your business, you could tell the individual, this is our protocol. We wear this for every home that we enter. You know, there's different ways you can handle it, and we can help you develop those programs. But thank you, Marina. That was fabulous.